Hello friends, all of you welcome to the learning series on internal quality control. First lecture, we have seen about the introduction of quality management system and application of internal quality control for quality management system. We have also seen the difference between quality control and quality assurance. So let us begin with the actual learning of internal quality control. Controls are the substances that contain an established amount of the substances being tested, which are the analyte. These controls should be tested in the same way as the patient sample. The purpose of control is to validate the reliability of the test system and to evaluate the operator's performance, environmental condition that might impact the results. Control materials are all the materials which can be used for the error detection. Control samples are full of biological fluids. They can be of different types of matrices that are serum, whole blood, urine, and maybe some other body fluids. This control material contain analyte which are determined by the laboratory, ideally at the concentration at which the decision limits are required for medical action. So first of all, we will see what are these quality control material. Now, as per ISO 15189-2012, in clause 5.6.2.2, they have clearly mentioned how the quality control material should be. So they have mentioned that the laboratory shall use quality control material that reacts to the examining system in a manner as close as possible to patient sample. Quality control material shall be periodically examined with a frequency that is based on the stability of the procedure and the risk of harm to the patient from an erroneous result. Whenever we choose a quality control material in our laboratory, there are some important properties which should be looked into the quality control material. So first of all, we will go through all these properties one by one. It should resemble a human sample, that is, human samples are of type blood, plasma, serum, CSF fluids or any other body fluids. The second thing is the analyte concentration should be at medically significant level. It should span the clinically important range of an analyte concentration. The third property is the material matrix should be as much like human sample as possible. So it should resemble with a human specimen. Fourth point is the constituent should be stable for a long period of time. Next is, after the vial has been opened and material prepared, it should be stable during the period of use. Next is, the control material should be ready to use and require minimal preparation. So there should be a minimal intervention while we are preparing a QC material or quality control material inside the laboratory. Convenient sizes of aliquots and vials can be prepared. So this vial to vial variability should be very low when we reconstituted vials are aliquoted into different vials. It should be of reasonable price, so it should not be overpriced and it should be affordable to most of the laboratories. The control material should be tested in the same manner as patient sample. So this again they are emphasizing, the control material should be analyzed or should be tested in the same manner as the patient samples are tested. So these are the properties of quality control material. Now regarding this control material, there are again several recommendations which has come up. Out of that, one is from Australian document AS4633, which is a supplementary document for ISO 15189 and it is a field application document. This recommends the QC material used must cover the analytical concentration encountered should be low, normal, high or low and abnormal controls as appropriate for the test. The second recommendation given is the control independent of those produced by the manufacturer of the test or analyzer should be used. That means the whatever control materials we are using, it should be independent of the analyzer or it should be independent of the reagent what we are using while performing a test. So these are called third party QC materials. Quality control materials can be of three forms. One is lyophilized, that is freeze dried form. The second one is liquid ready to use form, or the third one is liquid frozen form. So each format will have its own advantages and disadvantages, but most importantly, each type will have a different storage requirement and need to be handled in a different way. Freeze dried lyophilized material, they should be reconstituted with diluent before use. It is crucial to use correct diluent and the correct quantity of the diluent to ensure accurate quality control material results. The lyophilized control must be allowed time to be fully reconstituted before use. Now, how to reconstitute this lyophilized material, we will see in detail in the latter part of this series. The second form of quality control material comes from the manufacturer, are pre-diluted and are ready to use. So in this case, no reconstitution is necessary for this type of control. The third type of material is ethylene glycol based controls. These are pre-diluted in ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol controls should be stored in liquid form at 0 degrees Celsius. Control materials may be purchased, obtained from a central or reference laboratory, or made in-house by pulling sera from different patients. Now, how to prepare in-house pulled quality control material is a different part and will be covered independently in some another lecture series. Controls purchased commercially may be assayed or unassayed controls. Assayed controls have a predetermined target value and it is established by the manufacturer. When using assayed controls, the laboratory must verify the values using its own method, which is a part of validation or verification of IQC material. When using either unassayed in-house controls, the laboratory must establish the target value of the analyte. Unassayed controls are the controls where the targeted values are not determined by the manufacturer and which has to be established by the laboratory itself. Controls are available in high, normal and low ranges. Now there are some times when it is necessary to choose a control material that is near the low end of the detection limit of the method. Now we will see what are the limitations of control materials. The one limitation that the control material is frequently is non-commutable with the clinical patient sample. Commutable QC material is one that reacts in the measurement procedure to give a result that would closely agree with the expected for an authentic patient sample with the same amount of measurement. The serum or biological fluid matrix is altered. The matrix alteration is due to processing of biology fluids during product manufacturing, use of partially purified human and non-human additives to achieve desired concentration of measurements, and various stabilization process that alter proteins, cells and other components. This can affect the matrix. The impact of matrix alteration on the recovery of measurement is not predictable and is frequently different for different lot of QC material. QC material reconstituted by adding a diluent, vial to vial variability can be minimized by standardizing the pipetting procedure using the same pipette every time. Second limitation of QC material is deterioration of the measurement during storage. So many of these measurements are not stable and they get deteriorated while in the storage conditions. Measurement stability during unopened storage is generally excellent. But whenever we open a vial, control material is reconstituted or is stored in an aliquot, the stability of some of the measurements is not followed, which leads to drift into QC data, which require a correction over a life of lot of QC material. Measurement stability after the reconstitution, thawing or vial opening can be an important source of variability in QC result, and that can vary substantially among measurements. Another limitation is measurements concentration in multi-constituent control material may not be at levels optimal for all measurement materials. The limitations may be caused by solubility considerations or potential interaction between different constituents. Particularly, at higher concentration, it may be necessary to use supplementary QC materials to adequately monitor the measuring interval. Finally, at the end of we will see what are the different types of controls. They are first party control or dependent control, second is semi-dependent control, the third one is independent or third party quality control. So first party controls or dependent controls refer to use of any control material that has been produced by the instrument or reagent manufacturer for use on a specific test systems. Such controls are often manufactured from the same raw material as the calibrator, making them less sensitive to subtle changes in performance. As dependent controls are generally optimized for use with the manufacturer's test systems, this control can mask weaknesses and therefore are increasingly considered less effective than dependent controls. Second one in this category is semi-dependent control. Semi-dependent control materials, although produced independently of the instrument or reagent, is often supplied or recommended by the instrument or reagent manufacturer. It is this manufacturing relationship between the two that requires close scrutiny when considering if this control are fit for purpose. Although the control material is not produced by the instrument manufacturer, it is produced according to their exact specifications and therefore optimized to work with a specific platform. And finally, the third is independent or third party quality control. Independent or third party quality control material has not been designed or optimized for use with any instrument, kit or method. This complete independence enables the quality control material to closely monitor the performance of patient sample. In doing this, produce an unbiased independent assessment of analytical performance across multiple platforms. Some of the key benefits of third-party controls. Values assigned using a large number of independent laboratories, ensuring statistically valid targets. Highly consolidated control allow for space, time and ultimately cost savings. Boosted shelf life ensures continuity of supply and reduced cost. Reduce preparation times by removing the need for multiple instrument control. So these are some of the benefits of third-party controls. So with this, we have come to the end of this second part of the video in the series on internal quality control. In this video, we have seen the details of quality control material. So stay tuned for many more such lectures in this series about internal quality control. Thank you.